the weird thing was, like, with Eduardo, like, I didn't know who he wanted to invite. So we just did this, like, open invitation to, like, people living or dead. And apparently, like, Henry VIII and Johnny Cash and all of these people showed up at the church. And I was like, oh my God, I wish I knew the ghost of Johnny Cash was there, because maybe I would have thought twice and married him instead. Welcome to My Colourful Life. Hi, my name's Bricard. I'm a singer-songwriter and I married and divorced a ghost. I met Eduardo on a really, really dark, stormy, creepy textbook horror night. And I was struggling to get off to sleep and the rain was kind of lashing down on the window. And I just remember, like, tossing and turning for what seemed like ages and ages and ages. And then out of nowhere, I just felt this really, really intense, like, burning in my chest. And it moved down, like, throughout my body. And it was just painfully, painfully, slowly, and I could feel it, like, sort of taking over each, like, limb of my body, and it moved out really, really slowly out through my toes. And I could kind of, like, subconsciously remember, like, thinking, what on earth is going on? I need to turn the light on. So I, like, reached back to turn the light on, and something, like, grabbed my arm, pushed it forward, and stopped me turning the light on. So I reached back again to try and turn it on again, and this time I could turn it on, and I was literally just sitting there, like, trembling and shaking, and tears were, like, falling down my face, and I felt this kind of really, really warm air, like, on the side of my neck, and the words, like, whispered, like, I love you. He is a really, really handsome for a ghost, an absolute hottie. Like, I kind of just remember, like, just very, very disheveled looking. And you know when someone has, like, a really, really worn face? Like, he looked so almost troubled and, like, traumatized. Like, he had, like, a really menacing, but, like, a sort of brooding, handsome kind of menacing expression. And he had, like, shoulder length wavy hair. And I find it really hard to put an age on people, but especially, like, Victorian ghosts, they're kind of hard to, because obviously they don't look like the modern man. So I would kind of guess that he was sort of late 30s, early 40s. Yeah, still handsome and still youthful, but just very harrowed, like he'd lived a really traumatic life, which I guess ties into the fact that he was a soldier. So it's kind of, yeah, interesting. In the non-conventional sense of the word dates, I mean, we didn't sort of go hand in hand to the cinema and watch movies. We kind of had a lot of dates where we were sort of sitting in candlelight and trying to build up a communication style. And I kind of learnt that he could communicate through flickering the candle flame. So when I was kind of trying to piece together information about him, I would kind of ask him questions and the candle would flicker. And yeah, we kind of, it was, I mean, if you think about, there's something quite romantic or romanticized about ghosts. I mean, I don't know if it's because they're semi-unattainable or exciting or intriguing. So there was, like, a kind of romantic feeling. We got married in a chapel in London, like a little derelict chapel, which it took a little while to find somewhere. There was obvious hurdles when going down the religious, very religious route, because obviously ghosts and afterlife, a lot of religions don't see that as a feasible marriage. But I feel like I was very lucky because I found this place that aesthetically and emotionally felt like a church and felt like a chapel, and it had, like, beautiful stained glass windows. So I feel like I was able to have that kind of magical fairy tale wedding where I was walking down the aisle, I was, you know, I was going through the motions that you would go through in any normal marriage. So I was lucky to find that place that felt really special. I feel like the wedding was almost like the beginning of the end of our relationship, because I feel like that step to make it really serious. And I feel like sort of me publicly declaring my love for a ghost, it kind of took it to a level which was unsustainable in the real world, if that makes sense. And before that, it was like this kind of saucy, sexy encounter, which was exciting, but sort of taking it to the marriage level, knowing that he couldn't commit properly or knowing that he wasn't going to be present all the time. I feel like that kind of added an element of, not pressure, but it highlighted the flaws in our relationship and all the things that I found exciting. Like at the beginning, him not showing up, you know, whenever I wanted him to be there was like, oh, that's kind of hot, that's kind of interesting. But when you're married to someone, you do need them to show up all the time. You can't have them kind of like drifting off for days on end and not being present for key moments in your life. So I feel like what attracted me also put me off in the end. I think like from the beginning, like you have to remember, I wasn't prepared for sort of any of this, and you can't kind of Google how to handle a ghost. So over time, I sort of took advice from spiritual mediums to try and assert my boundaries with him and try and say, no, you're scaring me. No, I don't want your presence around me. But to be honest with you, it didn't really work. So I don't think I ever really did get any kind of control of the relationship at all. But that's probably to be expected due to the nature of the relationship. But I didn't reach a stage where I could sort of put my boundaries in place. You know, I feel like the only boundary I really had is getting him exercise. That was me firmly saying, look, I don't want you in my life. I don't want that scary presence anymore. On our wedding day, he made really, really inappropriate comments about spotting the ghost of Marilyn Monroe in the church. And as you can imagine on your wedding day, your groom sort of turning round and making a rude comment about anyone, any female, anyone at all. If you want to date a ghost, or why propose to me? Like, it didn't make any sense. It was just like I was being sort of tormented and played with, and it was just very, I just started to find it quite a dark relationship to be in. Like, I felt like to be someone who's so outgoing and so bubbly and so excited by life, I just felt like I was just getting dragged down by it. And it sort of being married to a ghost was becoming my whole identity. Like, you know, I couldn't really do anything without that being mentioned, you know, so it did kind of take over everything. The weird thing was, like, with Eduardo, like, I didn't know who he wanted to invite, so we just did this like open invitation to like people living or dead, and apparently like Henry VIII and Johnny Cash and all of these people showed up at the church, and I was like, oh my god, I wish I knew the ghost of Johnny Cash was there, because maybe I would have thought twice and married him instead. Yeah, it's mad, because I didn't know if Eduardo's family were going to turn up. I kind of felt that's the way it should be, like, let the groom invite who he wants to invite and take his word for whoever's turned up, I guess. It's a funny one, because I've never actually been one of those women, or people even, that has been desperate to find a boyfriend or a husband. I've always been very like driven and career orientated and very like free spirited. Like, I love to travel. I've never been one of those people that's desperate to find a man. I feel like I'm quite cautious in terms of putting myself out there, because even though to a lot of people I married a ghost, it was still like quite an intense experience. So I'm just cautiously putting myself out there, cautiously starting to date, you know, kind of trying to see where that takes me. And obviously dating humans is a lot different to dating ghosts. So it's kind of a whole new world, I guess. Thank you for watching My Colourful Life. Please like, comment, and subscribe.